The following program, The Russ Belville Show, is intended for responsible adults only. We advocate to the repeal of marijuana prohibition for adults. We discuss the science, culture, and controversy about America's marijuana laws. We do not advocate any illegal activity and encourage all listeners to learn their state and federal marijuana laws. Opinions and claims made by guests and advertisers on The Russ Belville Show are their own, and The Russ Belville Show cannot be held legally responsible for their validity or reliability. Viewer discretion is advised.
You take a seed, you plant it, you grow it, you dry it, you roll it, you smoke it. You take a seed, you plant it, you grow it, you dry it, you roll it, you smoke it.
And it goes down smooth. Hey!
Spanning the continent to bring you the truth about cannabis and marijuana law reform.
I smoke pot and I like it a lot.
From the promise of legalization. To the agony of prohibition.
One major responsibility is to encourage people to use less drugs.
The Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation.
I hear you had a question for me.
Now, here's your host, Radical Russ Belville.
Good day, tokers and tokettes, and welcome to the show. It's Tuesday, November 26, 2013, and it's got to be 420 somewhere in the world. Thank you for joining us. Plenty of news and information for us to get to today, including at half past, we are going to have, well, it's not exactly a cannabis community chat because it's going to be a one-way discussion. We're going to be hearing from Moms United to End the War on Drugs, and we've got a number of different moms joining us, including Joy Strickland and Gretchen Bergman, Diane Goldstein and Joyce Rivera, and more. So check that out. Some great videos coming up at half past. At 45 past, we'll have time to get into a radical rant, and I gotta know, what the hell is up with the cops in New Mexico? We've been telling you a few stories of some of the terrorism they've been inflicting upon American citizens who are suspected of drug crimes. This latest one is shocking even compared to the ones that we've told you before. So stay tuned in the Radical Rant and we'll tell you all about it. Also coming up on today's show, it's our Electric Tuesday for our Daily Toker Tunes. And so Electric Bob is going to be calling us and he has got us a great tune from a group called Altern 8, with the number 8. So we'll check that one out at 20 past when we get our relaxation break going. Also in Behind the Headlines, going to follow up on yesterday's rant on the Washington DUI numbers, because now Kevin Sabet's gotten a hold of them and he's proclaiming, oh my God, there's a huge increase in stone driving. We'll tell you why that's just not true. But we're going to open things up by our 420 radio news. In the headlines today, that Denver City Council that was looking at banning smoking pot on your own property if the public could see it. We'll tell you how that vote went down. Also, Seattle Center is going to be hosting a pot party to celebrate the passage of I-502 and it going into effect 1 year ago on December 6th. We were there on that night at Seattle Center when legalization took effect. They'll be having a 1 year anniversary party at Seattle Center. We'll tell you all the details when we get to the 420 radio news. Also in New Jersey, a lawmaker's trying to get past all the obstruction of that terrible medical marijuana program there by passing a bill to allow importation of medical marijuana from other states. There are going to be some hearings in New York State with regards to medical marijuana, and PolitiFact in Florida has weighed in on that sheriff who claimed medical marijuana would be easy to get. Stay tuned, we'll tell you all about it when we come back.
It's simply business. It's simply business. It's simply business, you know why they won't let us grow. It's simply business.
We'll be right back after these messages from our 420 friendly sponsors. Support these advertisers because their ad money goes straight to the Russ Belville Show. You're tuned into the Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation.
It's simply business. It's simply business. It's simply business. You know why they won't let us grow.
the law offices of Omar Figueroa would like to remind you to stand up for your rights. Please do not give up your precious liberties. There's nothing wrong with standing up for our constitutional rights, and in fact, it's the only way to honor the Constitution that recognizes our natural rights. Treat law enforcement with respect, and respect the Constitution by standing up for your rights. If you are detained or arrested, stand up for your rights by repeating, "I respectfully invoke all my legal and constitutional rights. I do not consent to any search and seizure. I want to remain silent, and I want to speak to my attorney, Omar Figueroa." Omar Figueroa has more than a decade of experience in federal and California courts and graduated from Yale University, Stanford Law School, and Trial Lawyers College. Please contact the law offices of Omar Figueroa at 415-489-0420 or 707-829-0215 or on the web at www.omarfigueroa.com. Cannabis Outreach Collective is an alternative health and wellness option located in Gladstone, Oregon, that serves patients in the Portland area and beyond. We are a full-service alternative health and wellness collective accommodating patients with natural, organic, holistic, and homeopathic remedies, nutritional guidance, advice, education, and medical cannabis, fully in accordance with Oregon OMMP law. You can find out more about Cannabis Outreach Collective on Facebook at COC503 or by emailing cannabisoutreachcollective503@gmail.com or by telephone at 503-853-1319. Check out our menu on Weed Maps and visit Cannabis Outreach Collective today. This is your 420 Radio News for Tuesday, November 26, 2013. I'm Russ Belville. Denver Council takes first step toward banning marijuana smoking in public view on private property. From the Denver Channel. Despite opposition from marijuana advocates, Denver City Council voted initial approval Monday night of an ordinance prohibiting people from using pot in a private yard or on a balcony if the user can be seen from the street or sidewalk. In a 7-5 vote, the council passed the measure on first reading. One opponent of the ordinance told the council, quote, "I would rather see police going after serious drug problems than playing security patrol for the Stepford Wives," end quote. On the other side of the issue, a parent argued that allowing residents to smoke pot in their front yards, quote, "undermines our conversations with our children by making it appear okay," end quote. Marijuana advocate Mason Tvert, however, says it's ridiculous that people can drink on their own property, but would be prohibited from smoking marijuana in the same locations. The council is expected to easily approve the second vote on the measure next Monday night. 500-toker pot party gets okayed outdoors at Seattle Center, from the Seattle Times. On the first anniversary of legal weed in Washington state, the city will permit a big pot party on the site of Seattle Center's Old Fun Forest Amusement Park. Pot activist Ben Livingston has the contract to prove it. It's a free adults-only event open to the public at which Livingston plans to have light music, light catering, and outdoor pot smoking by up to 500 people behind a double fence or smoking moat, as the permit says. Quote, "No matter how often you might have smoked weed at Folklife or Bumbershoot, you were civilly disobedient," Livingston said. "This is the first time ever on-site cannabis consumption is permitted at Seattle Center," end quote. Livingston's party will start 3 p.m. and run until 11 p.m. on December 6th. There will be an indoor area for partygoers as well as the outdoor smoking area, he said. He also notes that Pearl Jam's current North American tour will end that same night at nearby Key Arena. Quote, "Hey, if they want to come over," he said, "we could bill them as Hetty Vedder, Stoned Gossard, and Mike McWeedy," end quote. New Jersey lawmaker introduces bill allowing medical marijuana patients to buy from other state programs, from NewJersey.com. Registered medical marijuana patients in New Jersey would be allowed to buy the drug in another state where it's legal and consume it in New Jersey under a bill introduced in the state assembly today. Despite changes in New Jersey law that were meant to make a wider variety of marijuana strains and products available, the two operating medical marijuana dispensaries in the state are not producing edible products yet. creating a reciprocity agreement between New Jersey and the 19 other states in Washington, D.C. that permit medical marijuana is the next best thing, said Assemblywoman Linda Stender, a Democrat of Union, who introduced the bill. Patients who buy from out-of-state dispensaries must report the quantity of their purchases to the health department and may not exceed the monthly limit recommended by their doctor, according to the bill. Medical marijuana hearings to be held in New York State in December, from Syracuse.com. Democratic lawmakers plan to hold public hearings in Buffalo and Mineola next month on legalizing marijuana for treating medical conditions. The hearings are part of an ongoing push by certain lawmakers in Albany to sanction marijuana cultivation, sales, and use for certain diagnoses like cancer and other debilitating or life-threatening diseases. 20 states in the District of Columbia have established some form of legalization for medical marijuana. In New York, the democratically controlled state assembly has passed a version of legalization in past years. The Senate, run mostly by more conservative members in recent years, has yet to take the issue up for a vote. PolitiFact Florida, medical marijuana easy to get under proposed Florida law, sheriff says, from PolitiFact.com. Grady Judd, president of the Florida Sheriff's Association, wrote an editorial opposing the medical marijuana amendment in the Sun Sentinel, criticizing the ballot measure as essentially marijuana legalization. Quote, authors of the amendment have included a truck-sized loophole in the definition of debilitating diseases, which changes the word disease into condition. And what constitutes a valid condition, Judd wrote? Any condition where the use of marijuana would likely outweigh the potential health risks of someone who claimed to be sick. This means people who alleged minor ailments such as muscle spasms, neck pain, back pain, and even menstrual cramps have qualified for government-sanctioned pot smoking. End quote. Jed said that people with minor ailments could get access to marijuana if Florida's proposed amendment passes next year. He mentioned spasms and other chronic pain as minor conditions, when sometimes those conditions are quite serious. But compared to most other states, Florida's ballot language is flexible because it allows for physicians to determine whether a patient's condition qualifies for a license. We rate Judd's statement as mostly true. This has been your 420 Radio News for Tuesday, November 26, 2013. I'm Russ Belville. When we come back, we go behind the headlines on the report from Washington State Patrol on positive THC tests for drivers and how the media and prohibitionists are inflating those figures to promote a scare where none really exists. You're listening to The Russ Belville Show on 420radio.org. We'll be right back.
Starting up a medical cannabis business, you don't just want any attorney. You want a fired-up lawyer who understands the needs of cannabis consumers. The Law Office of Lauren Vasquez is your fired-up lawyer for the cannabis industry. Lauren Vasquez knows the details of California marijuana law from both a personal and professional angle. Lauren Vasquez rose from the ranks of college normal activist to become one of the Bay Area's best marijuana lawyers. Visit her website, firedublawyer.com, or call 1-855-MMJ-LAWS for more information. That's 855-665-5297 for Lauren Vasquez, your Fired Up Lawyer, or email firedublawyer@gmail.com. The number again is 855-MMJ-LAWS, 855-665-5297 for your Fired Up Lawyer, Lauren Vasquez. Lauren Vasquez is an activist attorney you can trust. Call today.
You know Herb Thrasher from the Herb Thrasher Flower Hour. Now get ready for Herb Age Designs for the proud cannabis consumer. Herb Age Designs, lifestyle gear for the 420 friendly. Herb Age Designs, home of the famous lighter leash. Herb Age Designs. Get your Herb Age t-shirts and hoodies and show your pride. Herb Age Designs. We've got frisbee golf discs and durable hemp gear. Herb Age Designs. We've got shot glasses, drinking glasses, coffee mugs, and beer cozies. Check us out on Facebook and online at herbagedesigns.com. And follow Herb Age and Herb Thrasher on Twitter. We'll see you at this year's Hemp Fest. Crank it up.
FourTwentyRadio.org presents Canna Truths with Denton Ramsey from Waco, Texas, every Thursday at noon Pacific
with replays Friday at 5 a.m., Sunday at 5 p.m., and Mondays at midnight right here on 420radio.org. Welcome back, everyone. Time for us to go behind the headlines, and we're reporting again on what we ranted on yesterday, and that is the numbers coming from the first 6 months of data in Washington State, from the Washington State Patrol, on how many THC-positive drivers there are. There are 746 of them in the first 6 months, compared to about 1,000 THC-positives for all of the year. For the past 4 years, each year about 1,000 of them, and this has caused the prohibitionists to scream that stone driving is up by 50%. But the data released for the Washington State Patrol don't actually say that. And as they raise this alarm for stoned driving following the legalization of marijuana, they're missing four very important facts. Number one, legally stoned driving is on the decline. From 2009 to 2012, the Washington State Patrol made about 20,000 stops each year for suspected impaired driving, and Washington State Patrol is on pace to hit that same number this year. So, it doesn't appear that cops are seeing more impaired drivers on the road. Of those 20,000 stops, cops ordered a blood test about one quarter of the time, about 4,800 tests in 2009, rising to about 5,300 tests in 2012. Of those tests, about one-fifth of the time, they came back positive for THC. This year, however, tests are coming back positive for THC about 27% of the time. The media have thereby declared that there's a great rise in stone driving because 745 tests come back THC positive over 6 months, when the average is about 1,000 a year. But by law, stoned driving is now defined as being over 5 nanograms of THC per milliliter of blood. In 2009 through 2012, all of the THC-positive tests, over or under 5 nanograms, was a stone driver. In 2013, those drivers testing below 5 nanograms are under the limit. And out of those 745 THC-positives, only 420 of them, yes, really, 420, of those drivers were over the limit. So that's on pace for 840 legally stoned drivers, which is far less than the 1,000 per year when all drivers with THC were considered stone drivers, and 325 of those THC-positive drivers who were under the limit now have a DUI defense that they didn't have before legalization. But still, aren't 745 THC-positives on pace for 1,490 over a year? And isn't that almost a 50% increase from previous years? Yes. But the proportion of those positives that are legally stoned is down. In 2012, 61.6% of the almost 1,000 THC positives were over 5 nanograms. This year, it's down to 56.4% of the THC positives that are over the limit. See, part of the reason we're seeing more tests showing stoned drivers is because cops are focusing more on stoned drivers. This year, the Washington State Police is on pace to conduct 200 more blood tests than the year before. Every year since 2009, the number of tests ordered has increased about 167. But now that there's a per se 5 nanogram standard for stone driving, cops have more incentive to go get the blood test in a marijuana case. Cops are also being trained to focus more on the behaviors indicative of stone driving. But just because you're catching more fish, that doesn't mean there's actually more fish. You may just be using bigger nets in better locations for longer periods of time. It's illustrative to remember that the patrol tells us they're still making the same number of stops for suspected impaired driving. So all the data are telling us is that cops are more likely to suspect and test for marijuana now than before legalization. And not only have we not seen an increase in impaired driving, but impaired driving fatalities are plummeting. The Washington Traffic Safety Commission keeps records on how many people died in Washington roads as part of its Target Zero program. In 2009, 169 people died in an alcohol-related traffic fatality, and 140 died in a drug-related traffic fatality. That's all drugs, not just THC. Those figures have declined every year, and in 2013, through 6 months, the state is on pace for an annual 88 alcohol fatalities and 80 drug-related fatalities. So they're all going down. This danger, supposed danger on the roads, cannot be demonstrated by any crash or fatality data. All they've got is they're catching more people who have THC in their systems, who probably had it in their systems before and just weren't getting caught. But that's not going to stop Kevin Sabet from trying to make hay out of it. That's for damn sure. We're going to talk more about Kevin in Hour 2, Toker Talk Radio. There's a three-part interview with him, and in two of the parts, I get name-checked. So stick around for that. In the meantime, it's 420, at least in the Mountain Time Zone. So enjoy yourself if you can, and if you can't, we'll enjoy ourselves for you. The Russ Belville Show. We'll be right back.
Talking to that reefer man.
Let him bring in the beat.
Adam Hand of Handmade Apparel produces quality custom designs for t-shirts, hats, and other apparel. Handmade Apparel is the official design shop for 420 Radio, The Russ Belville Show, Ganja John, and Cascadia Concentrates, among many clients who rely on Adam Hand for everything from short-run custom projects to full-run clothing lines. Adam's meticulous designs are individually crafted and screened in vibrant high-definition color. Visit handmadeapparel.biz to browse the selection of handmade gear or to get a personal quote for your own designs. Handmade Apparel, a proud supporter of 420radio.org.
Даня Данько. Я редактор журнала High Times. Отвечаю за отдел культивации, или проще говоря, выращивания. Приглашаем вас в Амстердам с 24 по 28 ноября, чтобы посетить ежегодный турнир Cannabis Cup, уже 26-й по счету. Там мы сравним множество видов марихуаны и гашиша из смежных кофешопов. Еще у нас там выставка товаров, семинары по выращиванию, ночные концерты и вручение премии за лучшие в мире сорта марихуаны. Хотите получить 10% скидку со стоимости билета? Используйте промокод Данько на сайте cannabiscup.com. Ждем вас!
Who would you rather your kids talk to about drugs? You? Or some guy? When your kids find out you've been lying to them about marijuana, who will they trust? Let's have a rational discussion about drug reform. Let's tax and regulate marijuana, restrict youth access, and create safer communities.
Everyone knows music and marijuana go together, so let's wind up our 20 after break with the Russ Belville Show's Daily Toker Tunes, the best in pod safe 420 music from around the web. Today is Electric Tuesday, featuring the latest in electronic dance music and other cutting edge genres. You can get downloads and more information about all our Daily Toker Tunes by visiting music.radicalrust.com. Now, sit back and enjoy your Daily Toker Tune.
All right, everybody, welcome back. 24 after the hour, and we're going all the way down to Arizona to talk to Electric Bob. How you doing, Bob?
I'm doing good. I'd love to be legally stoned in Arizona.
Wouldn't that be nice, man? It's a nice term to have, isn't it? Legally stoned.
Yeah, it is.
You know, people get to complaining about the 5 nanogram per se DUID law in Washington State. Need to realize that in Arizona, it's a zero tolerance for THC or metabolites. And if you fail the test, you get 48 hours in jail that minute.
Yep, exactly. There's no such thing as legally with anything with marijuana in this state.
That's right.
Even if you have a card.
That's right. Yeah. It's felony for any amount of possession. It's felony for having a pot pipe. It's felony for growing a single seedling, man. It's everything's a felony in Arizona if you're not medical. And if you are medical, you're stuck with a system that kind of sucks.
Yeah, exactly.
But we're fighting.
Let's talk about music.
Yeah, we're fighting for it. Let's talk about something better. This music you got for us. Band looked really cool. This Alternate. Tell us about them.
They're an older group out of the UK. They peaked in about 91 or 92. They were huge in the local club scene there. It's just, I was just browsing the web because I'm into a lot of old school stuff, and I just came upon these guys, and I'm like, damn, this is a good tune. I might as well play it for everyone.
Fantastic. What's the name of the tune?
It's Real-Time Status. It's the Hand of God remix.
All right. And any later information on this band? Are they still together, or is this relegated to...
I think they're still together. I don't know. I had to crawl the web to find out any info on them. They're real obscure.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's cool. It's Alternate 8, like the number 8, and the song is called Real-Time Status, Hand of God Remix. And thank you so much, Electric Bob. We'll see you next Wednesday. I'll be in Arizona. I hope to catch up with you.
Cool. See you then.
All right. Here we go. Alternate. Real-Time Status, Hand of God Remix. For your Electric Tuesday, Daily Toker Tunes.
Cannabis Cup van 24 tot en met 28 november in Amsterdam, in de Van Genthallen bij Amsterdam Roes. Verwacht alle coffeeshophouders uit Amsterdam die hun beste nieuwste producten laten zien. En hun wiet en hash wordt gekeurd door een panel aan deskundige wiet-experts die een uitreiking gaan doen wie de beste wiet en hash heeft van het land. Verder heel lekker eten, drinken, sapjes, toffe optredens in de Melkweg. Dus zorg dat je erbij bent. 26e editie van de Cannabis Cup.
Just like that, baby. Don't stop. I like it. You like it, baby? Yeah. Feels good, right?
Big Daddy thinks.
Won't you roll a ring, roll a ring, roll a
ring. Don't let him down.
The cannabis community includes a diverse set of activists and nonprofits working to end the prohibition of marijuana. We take the time to hear the stories of reform on the...
I'm Gretchen Burns-Bergman, co-founder and executive director of A New Path, Parents for Addiction Treatment and Healing. We advocate for therapeutic rather than punitive drug policies. I'm also a fashion show producer, but most importantly, I'm a mother. My two sons have addictive illness. My older son spent a decade of his life cycling through the prison system for nonviolent drug offenses and relapse. This was a tragic waste of human potential, a waste of taxpayer dollars and resources, and a very painful saga for our family. The war on drugs has failed. It is a war that has devastated our families and communities for decades. It has actually increased the harm associated with drug use and addiction. That's why I'm leading a movement of moms to end the violence, mass arrest and incarceration, and accidental overdose deaths that are the result of current punitive prohibitionist policies. We demand health-oriented and restorative strategies. I'm committed to the mission of Moms United to end the war on drugs for the sake of our families.
Hello, my name is Anita Fisher, and I'm a member and ambassador for A New Path, Parents for Addiction Treatment and Healing. Most importantly, I am a mother of an adult son who lives with not only addictive illness, but mental health challenges. I know that his many incarcerations for drug charges has not helped either condition. This is why I support the Moms United campaign against incarceration of people living with addictive illness. And here's my reason why.
Cool stuff like this.
Hello, my name is Ashley Birch. I am a proud mother of four boys, 7, 9, 9, and 10. I personally believe that the war on drugs is a joke and that the prohibition of marijuana needs to be ended. We are criminalizing people across this country over a plant that nature has given us to use for medicinal purposes. I am a proud supporter of Moms United to end the war on drugs, and I'm a proud supporter of legalizing and decriminalizing marijuana across this country. Please support us. These are my babies.
Hi, my name is Caroline Stewart. I'm a licensed clinical social worker and psychotherapist, and I'm the president of the board of A New Path, Parents for Addiction Treatment and Healing. But more important than any of those things is that I am a mother. I'm the mother of a young adult who's been suffering from addictive illness for many years, and I just want you to know that I believe in the mission of A New Path, which is to promote treatment instead of incarceration for nonviolent drug offenders. I promote decriminalization because too many of our children are being incarcerated when in fact what we really need is treatment. And so I propose that we all support the PATH campaign, Moms United Against the War on Drugs. Thank you very much.
Go.
My name is Denise Cullen, and along with my husband, Gary Cullen, we formed an organization called Broken No More. I'm a licensed clinical social worker, but most importantly, I'm a mother, and I'm a mother without a child. My son, Jeff Cullen, died of an accidental drug overdose in 2008 after struggling with addictive illness for 12 years. We are also founding partners of Moms United to end the war on drugs. The war on drugs is not a war on drugs. It's a war on people and families. The policies that have been in place for the last 40 years have been a dismal failure and have ruined so many lives. Along with the people who die every day, 100 in the United States at this point, to accidental drug overdoses, we have mass incarceration of people for nonviolent drug-related offenses, and that leads to destroying their possibility of a normal life when they get out of prison. The war on drugs is a failure in so many ways, and that's why I'm a proud member and proud to be a founding partner of Moms United to End the War on Drugs. Thank you.
Luther King once stated that injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. My name's Diane Goldstein. I'm a speaker for Law Enforcement Against Prohibition, a grandmother and a mother, and a strategic partner in the Moms United to End the War on Drugs campaign. I encourage not just women, but every member of our communities to join us as we continue to push the paradigm to embrace a new policy in drug prohibition that has caused so many devastating effects, not only on my personal life through the death of my brother, but also on our communities. It's time to put the peace back into policing, time to end drug prohibition, and embrace the campaign that treats drug addiction as a medical issue based on compassion, evidence-based practices, science, and a respect for human rights. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Elizabeth Stewart. I'm with Families to a Man California Three Strikes. My son, Jeremy Stewart, seen here in the picture, he's doing 70 years. His problem, he has a drug addiction. We need to stop this. The war on drugs is failing. I support Moms United to end the war on drugs. Help me and let me bring my son home one day. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Joy Strickland. I'm the founder and CEO of Mothers Against Teen Violence, where we are rethinking drug policy in Texas. I am a survivor of drug prohibition violence. My 19-year-old son was killed with a friend by two teenagers who were under the influence of illegal drugs, and they were engaged in low-level drug trafficking. I learned from this experience that any policy based on the prohibition model is a policy that is an egregious waste of human potential, it ruins lives, and it's a waste of tax dollars. And people who are abusing drugs or who are addicted to drugs need access to treatment. They don't need a prison warden. That's why I support Moms United to end the war on drugs. Happy Mother's Day, everybody.
I'm Joyce Rivera, and I am founder and executive director of St. Anne's Corner of Harm Reduction. I'm mom to five great kids, but I worry for their safety should they make a drug-related mistake. You see, I have seen relatives triumph over their addictions, only to then see their spirit mangled by bureaucracies designed for war. The war on drugs isolates the people you love. The war on drugs collapses them into categories. They're no longer Jane or Mary or Jack, but characters, caricatures whose behaviors are despicable. The war on drugs imposes barriers to treatment, to prevention, to care, to higher education, to loans, to credit, to employment. Your loved one may even lose their children and their hard-earned property. The war on drugs stigmatizes, and woe is she or he who is caught in its punitive, robust snare. I am speaking out because there are safer and more effective approaches. I am a mother and a proud member of Moms United to End the War on Drugs.
Hi, I'm Julia Negron, a person in long-term recovery, a certified addiction specialist, a member of the board of A New Path, Parents for Addiction Treatment and Healing, and a proud steering committee member of Moms United to End the War on Drugs. But most of all, most importantly, I am a mother. Today I work with people suffering from substance abuse disorders, but I once had my own struggles with substance abuse, and I lost both my sister and my mother to drug overdoses. However, nothing in my own experience or training prepared me for dealing with my son's life-threatening struggle with a long-term heroin addiction. The war on drugs has failed my son. He's served multiple incarcerations, 2 terms in California prisons. He has 6 felony convictions. And all this has added more problems to his life rather than help him re-enter and support a family and stay in recovery. The war on drugs turns out to be just a war on sick people. The war on drugs has failed. It's bad policy. And that's why I'm speaking out for more health-oriented, science-based, compassionate treatment. And that's why I'm a member of Moms United to End the War on Drugs. And this is what we're deciding. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Lisa Overton, and I am an addict in long-term recovery from drug and alcohol addiction. Most importantly, though, I am the mother of 2 lovely daughters. They are growing and thriving and doing well because I am an addict in recovery, and I am not in prison, and I am not on the streets. So treatment and recovery are of vital importance in our lives. The war on drugs has failed because it criminalizes people and it increases harm. It is a war on people. It's a war on the poor, a war on the addicts. It is not helping. These people need help, not punishment. This is why I am speaking out for those who don't have a voice, because we have locked them away instead of helping them. I am a proud member and supporter of Moms United to End the War on Drugs, because if my children ever find themselves struggling with addiction, I want them to get treatment, not punishment. And here's a picture of my lovely children. Here's the younger one. Here's the older one. Clean and sober. Thank you.
Hi. My name is Liz Perkins, and I am the chapter leader for the GRASP Association in the state of Delaware. I started the GRASP chapter after I lost my son John at age 30 on May 5th, 2011. To a heroin overdose. The 40-year-old war on drugs has not helped, has not worked, is not making productive members of society. It incarcerates, it stigmatizes, and we need to change that. I am telling you to please, because of me and my son John, whom I've lost for the last 2 years, who will never marry or have children or live a long life because of heroin. And I tell you that because I support Moms United to End the War on Drugs. I hope you will too. Thank you.
I'm Gretchen Burns Bergman, co-founder and executive director of A New Path, Parents for Addiction Treatment and Healing. We advocate for therapeutic rather than punitive drug policies. I'm also a fashion show producer, but most importantly, I'm a mother. My 2 sons have addictive illness. My older son spent a decade of his life cycling through the prison system for nonviolent drug offenses and relapse. This was a tragic waste of human potential, a waste of taxpayer dollars and resources, and a very painful saga for our family. The war on drugs has failed. It is a war that has devastated our families and communities for decades. It has actually increased the harm associated with drug use and addiction. That's why I'm leading a movement of moms to end.
My apologies on the repeat on that video, but great stuff from Moms United to End the War on Drugs. We'll find more of that information up on our blog at RadicalRust.com. Once I get a chance to post it, we'll put some links up to that playlist. I think their message is very, very important. All right, we're going to take a break, and when we come back, we're going to talk about New Mexico cops who are apparently out of control. It's time to call in federal coverage of this. Department of Justice needs to take a look at this. This has gone crazy, people. Stick around.
The Russ Belville Show is blogging and podcasting daily at RadicalRuss.com.
I'm Sub Cool from Team Green Avenger. At TGAGenetics.com, we are working on the leading edge of medical strains. Our strains are rigorously tested for THC, CBD, THCV, and other critical cannabinoids. Know your grow. Check out our genetic diversity at TGAGenetics.com, the home of Jelly Bean, Jack the Ripper, Vortex, and other award-winning cannabis strains.
The Russ Belville Show.
I'm not very good at singing songs, but here's a try.
According to lifelong pot smoker and rocket scientist Carl Sagan, making apple pies from scratch is extremely difficult.
If you wish to make an apple pie from scratch, you must first invent the universe.
Radical Russ and the Rolla J Studios crew will be right back after these messages.
A morning filled with 400 million suns, the rising of the Milky Way.
You want answers?
I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore!
You want answers?
You have offended my family?
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
And you have offended a Shaolin temple.
You can't handle the truth!
Surely you can't be serious.
I am serious, and don't call me Shirley.
Radical rant.
What the hell is going on in New Mexico? I'm telling you, folks, the more stories that come out of New Mexico, the less we have to fear that Heisenberg is the bad torturing guy there, and the cops who are after him are the ones we got to watch out for. Now, this started a while back. You know, we did the story on the body cavity searches. That was the one where David Eckert was pulling out of a Walmart, and he didn't stop enough for the stop signs. The cops pulled him over, thought maybe he was hiding some drugs up his ass, brought over a canine dog that said, oh, yep, sure enough, there's a dog up there. There's a smell there on the driver's seat. And they take him in to the hospital in another county, and they subject him to not one, not two, but three body cavity searches with their hands, and not one, but two x-rays, and not one, not two, but three enemas. 8 different attempts to try to find something up this guy's ass. They don't find anything, right? Turns out also the warrant was invalid in the county they were in. The colonoscopy was, oh, I forgot the colonoscopy. Don't forget the colonoscopy. The colonoscopy was done after the warrant had expired, and the drug dog hadn't been certified since 2011. So we were all outraged at that. And then you remember after that, we hear another guy who apparently hears this in the news and go, well, damn, that happened to me. Maybe I ought to speak up. Timothy Young, this guy made a turn without signaling. Cops pulled him over, used the same uncertified canine, which of course alerted, took him to the same hospital in a different county, and gave him some of the same procedures, including manual anal probes and some x-rays. And again, different county, different dog, all that kind of stuff. And again, they don't find any drugs. And then we were shocked when we got a third report, this one of a woman crossing. Now, this was Customs and Border Patrol, but she was crossing from New Mexico into El Paso. Drug dog alerts to the presence of narcotics. She was strip searched, asked to spread her genitalia and cough, and female agents performed manual probes of her anus and vagina. When no drugs were found, she was taken to the El Paso University Medical Center, forced to defecate in front of medical staff, then an x-ray, then another cavity search of the vagina and anus, and another CAT scan. A CAT scan, and no drugs were found. So we were pretty shocked when not one, not two, not three stories came out. Now, a fourth story came out, and you may have seen this one on ABC News, where the mother is in the minivan. The black woman, she's in the minivan with her kids. She's got like five kids in the car, including her teenage son. Gets pulled over for speeding. The traffic stop, this is near Taos, New Mexico. The officer walks up to the vehicle, speaks with the driver, walks away, I guess to run the license and registration, and then the van takes off. All right, so she's in the wrong. She takes off when the cop had her pulled over. She hadn't asked if she was free to go. There's a short chase. They pull the van back over. The officer, you know, pulls the driver door open and orders her out of the vehicle. She doesn't want to get out of the vehicle. There's a struggle. She's resisting arrest. Her teenage son comes around, the 14-year-old trying to, you know, attack the cop. He pulls his taser and says, get back. Kid gets back in the car. This escalates to the point where the woman has got herself barricaded in the minivan. Now, she's got little kids in this minivan. One of the cops is taking his baton and beating the back window out. Now, imagine being the little kid in the back of this seat, and there's somebody who literally shatters the window coming after you, and there's screams going on. You can see this video. It's up on ABC News. There's links to it. And then when she, you know, has had enough of the cops beating her window in, and again, I'm not necessarily saying she's behaving the proper way around police, but when she takes off, the cops pull their guns and start shooting at the van full of kids. And now this is freaking people out. Now, turns out when they arrest her, they do arrest her and charge her. What did she get charged with? Fleeing an officer, abuse of a child, resisting an officer, reckless driving, and possession of drug paraphernalia. So who wants to bet that part of what escalated this story is the mom going, shit, I got a pot pipe here. Oh, shit, if I got this pot pipe, they're going to pull the, you know, whatever. Or, given the fact that she's heard some of the news stories going on in New Mexico about how the cops are really fond of, you know, anally raping and vaginally violating all of these people that are suspected of drug crimes, that maybe she thought, God, maybe I ought to get somewhere where it's a little safer. So we were outraged when it was that, right? We saw that video. I was like, oh my God. Wait till you get a load of this story. Woman claims officer sprayed mace on genitals from KOB.com. A New Mexico woman claims she suffered for weeks after a Bernalillo County corrections officer strip searched her and sprayed mace in her vagina. According to court records, police arrested the woman for a probation violation tied to a previous drug case. While at the Metropolitan Detention Center, the woman said two officers strip searched her and asked her to bend over at the waist. That's when they noticed a plastic baggie protruding from her vagina. Instead of taking her to a doctor to have the baggie removed, she said one of the officers, a woman named Blanca Zapater, sprayed a chemical agent directly on her genitals twice. Her attorney said the chemical agent was mace. The woman said she suffered, quote, severe pain that lasted several weeks, including burning, swollen genitals, and painful urination, end quote, according to court documents. The official police policy at the Metropolitan Detention Center states that chemical agents are only used when there is a threat to the safety of staff or inmates. So I theorize here, my hypothesis is that somewhere along the line, baggies of drugs have leapt out of women's vaginas and viciously attacked police, thus requiring the mace to make sure the vicious vaginally hidden baggie of drugs didn't attack. What the fuck? This is clearly torture. This is clearly a sick, someone getting their sick jollies punishing someone. Yeah, the woman shows up to jail and she's got contraband tucked away. So, procedure is, take her to the hospital, get rid of the contraband, add some more charges. That's what you do. But to spray mace on the woman? OMG. Of course, the lawyer says that his client, the woman, was cooperative with officers. Quote, our client did not resist the correction officers. She didn't give him a fight. End quote. She stripped. She squatted and coughed and bent over. That's where they found the baggie. Do you think stories like this are going to encourage the next woman who might be hiding some drugs, or might not, to want to be cooperative with the police? This is going to engender any sort of respect for law enforcement? Or does this escalate the simple holding of a pot pipe into something that makes you want to run from the cops? Does this escalate hiding some drugs in your body to something that makes you want to shoot your way out? This is the true harm of the war on drugs, is how much it has eroded our basic understanding of fundamental liberty and our basic relationship with officers who are supposed to protect and serve. Not search and arrest. Protect and serve. Who was protected and served by this corrections officer spraying mace on the woman's vagina? They had already gotten the contraband. They'd already found the contraband. The woman was cooperative. The woman was not attempting to fight back against the officers in any way. But like terrorists and torturers across the globe, all you've done is incited the hatred, incited a want for vengeance, a want for violence against those who would perpetrate such harms, against people who, at most, in the case of the woman in the van, were guilty of speeding. And at most, in the case of the woman in the jail with the mace, a probation violation and trying to smuggle a little bit of personal amount of weed or drugs or whatever drug it was. And to think it's gone this far, and to think that we as a country are seeing this happen, and there's not widespread hue and cry, that there's not pitchforks and torches and people lining up at the legislature to call for an investigation of this, to call for an end to this. This is more than just, I want, you know, the New Mexico State Police to look at it or the governor to form a task force. This is Department of Justice level stuff. This is FBI level. This is civil rights level stuff that needs to be investigated in New Mexico. Because these things, like Abu Ghraib, for example, aren't just one-off little things that take place because a few people at the bottom of the chain of command are a couple of bad apples. No. Things do not get to this level without some level of wink-nudge approval from those above them. This must be investigated. Federal task force at minimum. There is something rotten in New Mexico, and it's not Heisenberg's blue meth. All right, folks, that's all the time we got here for Hour 1. But stay tuned for Hour 2, Toker Talk Radio. There's a three-part interview with Kevin Sabet. I mentioned twice, so we're going to take a look at what sort of BS he's swirling around. For Brian the Red, I'm Radical Russ. Thanks for joining us. And until next time, take care of each other, Tokers.
This is the Russ Belville Show. The Russ Belville Show is blogging and podcasting daily at radicalrus.com.